Good evening. My students never reply like that. I am hopeful that I will figure out all the technology that I need to. Including how to turn on something. I was given the topic, Georg Grossmann and Wartburg and the Iowa Synod and Waverly. And I've had fun with it, more than I expected that I might. And in order to tell that story, I find there are three stories that have to come together. Somehow I have, there. Some of you recognize this image. This is Wilhelm Lea. Anytime that you talk about Wartburg and its origins, the many Wartburgs and their origins, we have to start with Wilhelm Lea in a small Bavarian village, Neuendelsau, seeing all sorts of mission activities available that the world needed. One of those involved, now I'm going in the wrong direction. I think I figured out which buttons I need to push. One of those ideas for mission involved this fellow, Georg Grossmann, who was a teacher, trained as a teacher, a successful teacher in Germany, and whom Lea sends out in 1852 to Saginaw, Michigan, to establish a school for the training of teachers for parochial schools, German Lutheran parochial schools. The Germans in the United States needed leadership. They needed educational leaders, and Georg Grossmann gets tapped to do that. He also studies for the ministry and is ordained before he comes. He arrives in Saginaw, Michigan, not finding a building, but finding a lot and a pile of lumber. He and his students had not expected that part of the curriculum that first year was going to be carpentry. But they build the school, they get a small start, but the German religious leaders in that area were Missouri Synod, and Lea and Grossmann had a variety of differences with that synod, and so Saginaw was not going to be the place where Wartburg, that school, it's not yet called Wartburg, would stay. And so they're only in Saginaw for a year. Then they begin what is only a series of moves that Wartburg will have through the years. They go to Dubuque, where at least they don't have to build a building. And they're there for a few years, and during that period of time, another Lutheran leader took a group of Germans to Clayton County and founded a colony called St. Sebald. In 1854, Grossmann and several other Lutheran leaders formed the Iowa Synod. In 1857, the school would leave Dubuque and move to St. Sebald, the argument being that there was more space to grow there. They had farmland that could help support the creation of the college, that moving to St. Sebald would be a good thing. And it was. They build a building. But because they were a new synod, they found that they needed pastors more than teachers. And so they needed a seminary. And so we have the beginnings of a Wartburg seminary. And in order to train students to be ready for seminary study, They needed a preparatory course that would essentially be a college. Along the line, the mission that had originally brought Grossmann to the United States, the goal of establishing a school for the training of teachers, falls by the wayside. But it is not forgotten. In 1878, and we have jumped ahead a stretch, the college has moved on to Illinois in two different places while this is happening. And in 1878, Grossmann restarts his school for training teachers using space in an orphanage in Andrew, Iowa. But that space is too small. It won't serve in the long run. And so Grossmann is going to need to look elsewhere. Here's where I come to a different story. That story starts in 1853, when a group of German immigrants who'd been in the Cook County, Illinois area moved to Iowa and settled in Maxfield Township. If you look at the place, at the names on a plat map of Maxfield Township, you will be struck at how many of them are familiar and German, including people, and Bruns, and Seeger, and a variety of others. Well, these people had come from a Missouri Synod congregation. They invited their pastor to come visit them, and he did so, and then sought assistance from the Missouri Synod for a pastor for them. They get a Missouri Synod pastor for a couple of years, but he leaves and isn't replaced. Then, an Iowa Synod minister found them. And in 1859, St. John's Lutheran Church at Maxfield becomes one of the Iowa Synod congregations. And it does fine for about a dozen years. But then, something that I think is remarkable happens. A new young pastor, well, not quite so young, he'd been a pastor for a number of years, including, incidentally, I discovered from reading his obituary, in the town in Wisconsin where my mother-in-law lives. Funny how there are always these connections. Fellow by the name of Reverend Paul Bredow. I think Bredow is one of the unsung heroes of German Lutheranism. He is certainly an unsung hero here. And some decades ago, maybe a century ago, people might have recognized the importance that he had in Lutheranism in Bremer County. But I think that story has largely been lost, because Bredow, starting in 1871, as the pastor there and staying at St. John's for 28 years before he retired, would be one of the great missionary pastors. One of his goals would be to seek out German settlements, draw them into the Iowa Synod. And if you look at Lutheran churches in this area, there are a large number of them that have Bredow somehow appearing in their history, including this congregation. Because in 1872, Reverend Paul Bredow is the person who helps organize St. Paul's Lutheran here in Waverly. I'm interested in census data. And if you were to look at the Iowa census in 1880, Bremer County had a population of a little over 11,000. It had a foreign-born population of about 2,900. Of that foreign-born population, 1,981 of them were born in the German Empire. 8 of them were born in Norway and Sweden. I would note that there was little likelihood that a Norwegian Lutheran school was going to locate in Bremer County. But I have to note, as a Swedish American, this is the only county in the United States that is named after a Swede, Fredrika Bremer. We often pronounce her name Bremer these days, and that's fine. It's been Americanized. But it's the only county named after a Swede. She never set foot in the county, but she had traveled in the Midwest about 1850. The Iowa governor thought that we ought to honor her in the naming of a new county at a time when they were trying to come up with names for new counties. And so we're in a Swedish-named county, but a center of German immigrants. Back to Andrew, Iowa, and Georg Grossmann, and that story. The orphanage in Andrew is simply too small for the school that Grossmann hopes to establish. And so he looks around. He looks around at what other places might serve it and what sorts of resources might be offered to help support that school. There were three towns in the running. Andrew was hoping to keep the school there. It failed. Mitchell in Mitchell County hoped that it would attract it. It failed. And Waverly. I've gotten ahead of myself a bit. Where would this school land? Well, here I think is another part of the story. Another part of the story that has continued for decades. Because Waverly was interested in the possibility of having a school. It was willing to offer some assistance for the creation of that school. This is one of the first mentions of the possibility of a German college appearing in the Waverly newspapers, 1879. A card from P. Bredow, pastor at St. John's, talks about the advantages of attracting a school and what all sorts of subjects that might offer, not only to Germans, but also to others in the area. Well, that gets the ball rolling, although not particularly fast. I am hoping that I will advance a slide. Aha, no. There. There's a meeting called. Here in Waverly, some people get together arguing that we ought to call a meeting and try to drum up support. And I would note that the result of this meeting is that there are groups picked out to go out and solicit subscriptions, solicit donations for the creation of this school. You might note some names that are German there. Bruns, Fosselman, Wente. But there are also some non-German names there. The person who presides over that meeting is Oscar Burbank, one of the pioneer physicians of Bremer County. Also a 49er. He had a really interesting life. And pretty soon, there's a call for bids. We want to get people, contractors, bidding for the construction of a building which will be the entire school, at least as it starts. It's now Old Main. And note the top name on that list. P. Bredow. Reverend P. Bredow. And here's one of the great joys of doing research in old newspapers. You never know what you're going to find. Because that's the guy who got the contract. Will William R. Knight. I was hoping that it was a misprint, that maybe that middle initial might be B, and it would be prophetic. Alas, it was an R, and it stayed an R. That's one bit of Wartburg's history that I've never run across before. And one only finds it by reading newspapers from 1879 and 1880. Well, in the days to come, in the months to come, that school would get started, the construction of it. The cornerstone is laid in June. I'm disappointed that the Waverly Republican commented, "Lack of space forbids further comment beyond these brief lines." I would have liked to have known more about what that was. A bit later, we have a description of what that building looks like. This is from August of 1880, late August. By that point, the three stories have been built, but the remaining part of the walls for the attic have yet to be built. To read just a couple of passages from that, the building is 40 by 60 feet, three stories high, with basement of stone and attic. And I have to say, in 1880, that must have been a pretty imposing structure on that part of Waverly. There are 64 windows and four outside doors in the building. The basement is divided into rooms as follows: furnace room, pantry, dining room, and kitchen to be used for the students. The first floor to be divided first, one half for a classroom and the other half as living rooms for the professors. I used to have an office in Old Main. I'm not sure I'd like to live in the building, but it was a nice building to have an office. The second story apartments are all classrooms, while the third story will be divided into sleeping rooms for the students. I've occasionally wondered, my office used to be on the third floor of Old Main. I've occasionally wondered, okay, if we could resurrect the conversations that took place there so many years ago, they would be amusing or horrifying. I'm not sure which. In late November of 1880, Wartburg College, it's not really, that term really isn't used at that point. The German College is dedicated, and this is a relatively early photo of Old Main. I say relatively early because I don't see North Hall behind it. So that's a few years yet in the future. And my next slide is from a map in Waverly. And it's also one of the neat things about doing research and finding connections that one never anticipated. That part of Waverly at the time had streets, north-south streets, named after trees. And in that area, they were named after fruit trees. Old Main, Wartburg College in its totality at one point, was built on the north end of a segment of Orange Street. I couldn't make that up. We don't know where orange and black came from as Wartburg College's colors. That decision was made when the college was in Clinton, and the exact timing has been lost. I've not at least been able to find it, and I've looked through a lot of Clinton newspapers hoping that I could find an answer to that. But Wartburg College used to be the head of Orange Street. It was later renamed in 1925 College Street. And then about 1930-31, the town went to the present designation of numbered streets. And so we lost all the interest. The college's address when I came to Wartburg was 222 9th Street Northwest, which ran just past the west side of Luther Hall. Well, Grossmann served as the president for the Iowa Synod for 4 decades. He retired from that task finally in the early 1890s as his health declined. And probably at least the only institution related to the Synod itself that I know of that comes to Waverly, it gets established in Waverly in this period, is the Wartburg Publishing House. The other institutions that are German have roots that are local and are here because there are large numbers of German immigrants in this area. But the Wartburg Publishing House stood on Bremer Avenue, right across from what is now the Bremer County Historical Society. Some of you may recognize this building. It's no longer there. Now the Veterans Memorial is there. But this used to be a steakhouse when I came to Waverly. For some reason, I think the name is Emmy's, but I'm not sure if that's true or not. I'm glad to hear someone nodding, see someone nodding. Just a couple of other slides, including maybe an odd photo. Bredow, after retiring from his 28 years of service at St. John's, would move to Waverly, settle in the community. He would pass away about 1910, and here's a photo of his marker up at the cemetery, Harlington. But I also have a photo of his coffin. You never know what you're going to find on eBay, because that's where I found this photo and bought it. It was one of 2 photos being offered. I decided I could only afford one of them. The other one showed him laid out, not his coffin with a photo on it. And I thought that was just a bit macabre. But I was delighted to add this to my collection. And I would note that he is just down the hill from Georg Grossmann, who incidentally was his father-in-law. Grossmann had a number of daughters who married Iowa Synod pastors. At least 2 of them are buried in Harlington Cemetery. And, you know, so there's sort of a family connection in bringing Wartburg to Waverly. That may well have helped. And by the way, if you walk around in Harlington Cemetery, and I occasionally do tours up there, you'll find a number of markers just like this. I don't know if Lutheran pastors got a discount price on it, but if you find one like this, odds are there's a Lutheran pastor buried under it and his wife. And that's the end of my story. Thank you.